Good morning, Dexter Lake Church. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. We are so happy that you have joined us today. Our youth are back. Woo-hoo! They are excited. Yes. Are you excited to worship the Lord this morning? Yeah. Feel free to join us up here at the altar if you'd like. If not, worship from your seat. Hallelujah. Woo-hoo! We'll be right back. come here to worship the Lord this morning. Come on, just lift your voice and raise your hands and say, I'm available, Lord.
If it seems like we're going places we've never been, like we've left all we know to chase a voice on the wind, we're not lost, we're just looking. It feels like we've laid our strength to the side.
you are in the valley right now, but you're not. You're not. God is with you. He will go before you. He will go beside you. He will go behind you, and he promised he would walk with you. No matter where we're at, our God is bigger. Our God is bigger than whatever you are facing. Our God is for us, then who can be against us? You may feel like the enemy is pressing in right now, but press back through your praise. Press back. Our God is bigger, bigger than anything we can face. Press back in the mighty name of Jesus. Our victory is in Jesus.
Our victory is in the person of Jesus. Our victory is in the one who was at the right hand of the Father and didn't count himself too high to come down and be the propitiation for our sins, to be the atonement for our sin. Our victory is in his name, because it's in his person, because he decided, he said, nobody takes my life, but I can come and I'll lay it down for you. And if I lay it down for you, I won't stay down. And our victory is in the name of Jesus, not because he died, but because there's a resurrection on the other side of the cross. Our victory is in him, because he's not still dead. He's right now at the right hand of the Father again, making intercession for you and for me. So we have victory. I wish somebody else would grab a flag today and just begin to wave the banner. Name just need a warrior. Sometimes this flag is unfamiliar in my hand. Sometimes you just need a warrior. Rachel, is that one of them popping flags? I want you to do it, because sometimes you need a warrior. Woo! Rachel, I want you to come. I want you to come right up here, and here's what I want. I'm gonna have her. She's gonna lead us. She's a Levite. I'm gonna have her lead us. I just want you right here, because this is what I'm believing. I'm believing that there's some people who came in today with some stuff. And when she pops this flag, I want you, it's like I see it when she pops the flag, it's like the devil wincing. It's a blow to the devil every time. And as she pops this flag over you, I want to just continue to sing the song, but as she pops this flag, I want you to just see your chains falling off. I want you to just begin to see those things that were beating you up when you came in. Right now, they're being defeated. Right now, every wave of this flag, every time it pops, we're saying, God is my banner. The name of Jesus is my banner. And he pushes back the darkness, and nothing can stand against him. And if he's for us, who could be against us? So come on, just lift your hands and say, my victory's in Jesus' name. Come on, pop that flag.
Yes.
You know what these flags represent? They're a visual of what your praise is doing. You don't need a flag. You don't need a flag. The flags are a natural representation of what your worship and your praise does. Now I want to show you this. This is the Holy Spirit just showed me this. If I'm worshiping and this is my worship, I want to show you something. I'm about to mess everything up. Look, watch this. Better move. What does that mean? It means when we worship, all the demons that want to attach to us, all the struggles that are around us, they got to watch out. And like, I know, Kelly, I know you're not a demon. But listen, I may be over here worshiping, demons trying to get on my side. The demon never knows if my worship's gonna come over here. The demon doesn't know. And I'm telling you, as you worship, it's a banner around you. The name of Jesus is a shield around you on every side. That a thousand will fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but nothing shall come nigh unto you, because you're a worshiper, because the name of Jesus covers you. So I want to just sing it one more time, and I want you to just envision that your voice is doing what the flag is doing. My victory's in Jesus' name, and no weapon in hell could would be formed against me and prosper. Nothing can win against the name of Jesus. Come on, I want you to just say it one more time. My victory
is in Jesus' name.
Come on.
That I've ever been to. But one of the things, and the Holy Spirit's been like pushing me up here this entire time, and it just goes right along with everything that's gone on so far this morning. But Friday afternoon, we arrived and had hotel complications. And so here I am trying to figure out all these things. My leaders were amazing. They had the kids. I'm trying to figure it out. Danielle's at a different hotel trying to wheel and deal, which she did amazingly, by the way. And I'm stressed. I'm coming back to the hotel that we were at, just stressed out and worried about the kids, worried about whether they're having a good time or whether they're bored or not. And I pull up to an actual praise party in the parking lot of our hotel. They weren't worried. I don't even know how it happened, but I pull up and I hear praise the Lord. And suddenly everything, all that worry and all that anxiety, all those thoughts about, man, this is not a great start to the weekend, went all away because there they are. And you know what? We go to these things. And that kind of like spontaneous praise happens like throughout the weekend, but I've never seen it happen before we even went to a service. They were ready, and they weren't gonna let a circumstance, they weren't gonna let a situation, a thing that could have bothered them. something life changing throughout the weekend. And so I got to that service and I said, if my teens can praise and forget what was going on, I can do the same thing. I am going to praise my Lord with abandon, and I am not going to let those circumstances, I'm not going to let the enemy and the things that he had to ruin the entire weekend get in the way of it. And God moved, and it was so good. So when you sing these songs, this is how I fight my battles. Man, it's so cool to watch. What an awesome, awesome objective thing that we just witnessed, that the enemy has to get away at the sound of Jesus' name. He has to. And Revelation says that every knee will bow, every knee, every tongue will confess at the name of Jesus, at the name of Jesus, at the name of Jesus. So whatever circumstance you're dealing with, whatever is going on in your life, speak Jesus over it. Speak Jesus over it. Sing your praises, and the enemy has to flee. So let's do that one more time.
That really just rocked me, and I just want to share it with you. I heard a song come on. I don't even know the name of the song, but there was a lyric in that song that said, our faith is not fragile. Our faith is not fragile. Like it's something that'll shatter if we do the wrong thing. So we treat, and the Holy Spirit said, we treat our faith like it's fragile. We treat our faith like we don't want to test it too much because it could break. But I want to tell you today, your faith is not fragile. Your faith will not break. Your faith is strong and powerful because it's in the name of Jesus. And you don't have to treat your faith like it's something that you don't know if you're ready for something or not. I want you to begin to believe God for audacious things. Begin to believe God for the big things. That's the only way that your faith can continue to grow, and you can just get to that place where you know, my faith is not fragile. My faith isn't going to break. I'm not afraid to walk into any situation because I know God goes before me. I know He prepares a table for me in the presence of my enemy. I know that He said I could dwell in the house of the Lord for all of my days. I know that God is a good God and He's got my back. And so my faith is not fragile. I came to tell you this preacher's faith in this house this morning is not fragile. And if you can't believe for yourself, I came today to believe for you. I just want you to know, when I was waving that flag, I wasn't even waving it for me. I'm saying, God, I'll worship you. I'll praise you for somebody else's miracle today, God. I know He's good to me, and I'm thankful to have Him. And I know my faith isn't broken. It's not fragile. So I'm just praising God for you today. And whatever you came in needing today, I want you to know God is able. God is able. Say, Jesus. I want you to say, Jesus, because that's the power. That's the person. Say, Jesus is able. Come on, say it again. Jesus is able to do exceeding, abundant, and above all I could ask or I could think, according to the power that works in me, according to my faith, according to now faith, according to this faith, for which we believe, in Jesus' name, amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, worship team. Hallelujah. Amen. This is how we fight our battles. Praise God. It's so good to have all of the youth with us today. As Pastor Justin said, they came coming back from Winterfest. And at this time, we can actually dismiss middle school if we want to. If not, y'all stay in the class, or stay in the room today. This word will speak to you if you'll allow it to. And I'm gonna jump right in the word. Is everybody okay with that? I want to jump right in the word. I believe that the atmosphere is set for the word. Everybody, watch your eyes because we're getting ready to turn the lights on. Boom. God said, in the beginning, there was nothing. God said, let there be light. Now there was still nothing, but you could see it. That's the UIV. That's the uninspired version. I read that sometimes. It's the Paul's version. 2 Samuel chapter number 5. It's access week. Access week this week. Meaning we are trying to deep dive. Access weeks are the weeks. They're the third week of the month, third Sunday of the month. And Access Week, we are trying to deep dive into our person, to begin to believe God for things that will make us better. How many of y'all know that you need some work? Everybody else has just arrived. You know, I don't need work. I've attained. Lord just needs to take me now. But no, I need some work. We need some work done on us. We need to become better. Paul said it like this: I have to decrease so that He can increase. He said, you need to work out your salvation daily with fear and with reverence and respect and trembling before the Lord. And so we all need some work. And on Access Sundays, the reason Access Sundays is the Sunday that we use to kind of deep dive is because again, we have this initiative. I won't keep reminding us that much throughout the year, but we have this initiative to reach, which is an acronym: to reach, to engage, to access, to champion, and then to harvest. Okay, and accessing and engaging, which is last week, and engaging, we're being evangelistic. We're reaching out. We're engaging our community. We're engaging one another. But access is different. Access is when we allow other people or God to access the inner parts of us. I just sat through a teaching yesterday, a very rich teaching, and the teacher was talking about how he continuously puts himself out there and he gets hurt a lot. And there's this tendency to want to not open yourself up so that you don't get hurt anymore.
Anybody remember when we preached about walls? There's this tendency to not put yourself out there, to not let access to yourself happen so that you don't get hurt anymore. But this preacher, he said, I will continue to allow access to me because the love that I get to have for people supersedes the hurt that I feel, even when I have to go through the struggle that I struggle with. Even if they hurt me, he talked about some times when he had been really hurt by people he had given access to himself by. And he said, but even looking at that, they hurt me to the nth degree. They hurt me bad. But when I look back, I choose, and God has allowed me that when I look back on that relationship, I don't look at the hurt that was caused in that one season of severance. I look back at all the love and all of the things that we did together, all of the good things. He said, you can choose to remember whatever thing you want to remember, but you need to continue to allow access to yourself. You need to continue to give access of yourself away. I'm not even getting very many amens today because I know I'm messing with y'all's brain right now. You're literally thinking as I'm talking, like he's already started and he's already getting meddling in my business and he's telling me that I don't need to have a hard heart towards someone. He's already telling me that I need to open myself up when every time I open myself up, I get hurt. You better believe that's exactly what I'm saying to you. And let me tell you why, because we're supposed to do what that name that we just kept repeating. We're supposed to do what Jesus did. And I want to tell you that every time you betray him, every time you hurt him, every time you do the thing you shouldn't have done, he is hurt, but he doesn't stop opening himself up to you. He still says, I'm here with arms open wide, ready to receive you back. And if Jesus can do it, then you and I better learn how to do it. So it's Access Week. But this week, I want to dive into who we are, and I want to talk to us about a powerful concept that is in the scripture that we talk about it. We talk about this thing. We talk about breakthrough. We talk about getting breakthrough, but we don't know where it's at scripturally, and there's a reason for that. I want to read the scripture for you, and I want to show you just a little interesting thing in the scripture. Many of you will have not seen this. And it's kind of unpopular, and it hasn't been preached often because of one thing. I'll show it to you. So 2 Samuel chapter number 5, verse 17 through 21, let's read the scripture together. Now, when the Philistines heard that they had anointed David king over Israel, all the Philistines went up to search for David. And David heard about them coming. And he went down to the stronghold. I just gotta stop for a second, and I wanna remind you that David was the one who said, the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it, and they are saved. And when this scripture says that David heard the enemy was coming for him, the Bible says that he went into the stronghold. That may have been a physical place, but I wanna tell you that was probably when David penned, I'm running into the name of the Lord because I know the name of the Lord is a stronghold. That's a strong tower, and the righteous run into it, and they are saved. So when the enemy came after David, he said, I'm going to turn to the Lord. I'm going to run into his name. My victory's in Jesus' name. It's almost like it was prophetic that the worship team was singing it today, that my victory's in his name. The righteous run into the name of the Lord, and they're saved. And the scripture goes on to say, the Philistines also went and deployed themselves in the valley of Rephaim. They deployed themselves. They went out and they postured for war. I want you all to know that right now there's an enemy of your soul and he is posturing up for war against you. He's posturing up for war against you. I was waving that flag, and when I put that flag down, I don't know why, I just was kind of walking like this. Just kind of shoulders back. Posturing myself for like, get out of my face, devil. And the enemy has postured against David in this moment. The enemy is postured up against you. The enemy's showing you a face, a facade that says, I'm going to get you. I'm going to destroy you. I'm going to kill you. I'm going to steal from you. And they went out and arrayed themselves in the valley of Rephaim. And David, this is powerful, David inquired of the Lord. Man, what a powerful thing. What a powerful thing. This is where we mess up. The enemy postures up against us, and we either do one of two things. We either cower down, or we run away, or maybe we fight. But here's the thing. David didn't do either of those things. He said, I'm not going to do nothing till I've heard from God. I know what I'm facing, but I'm not going to do nothing until I hear from God. I know I could run away and protect myself and live to fight another day, but I'm not going to do nothing until I hear from God. I know that I could go fight and I could win or lose, but have a noble death if I die, but I'm not going to do nothing until I hear from God. This is where we get it messed up, church folks. Because we see God over there walking on the water. We want to walk on the water too. And we just get out of the boat, and next thing you know, we start to sink. Because we didn't inquire of the Lord. Peter said, Lord, if it's you, bid me come to you. And Jesus said, come on. And he had to wait on the word of the Lord before he stepped out of the boat. David had to wait on the word of the Lord before he knew what he should do. We have become a people who just do what we want to do and hope that God will fix the problems. We'll just, you know what? I'm just going to do my best and let God sort it out. That's why we sit there and circle mountains all the time. That's why we keep struggling with the same demons over and over again. That's why you can't get deliverance from that thing you've been battling for 20 years. That's why you can't put it down. That's why you still struggle with your phone in private times. Because you don't inquire of the Lord and say, God, how help me do this. How do I do this? One of the most powerful passages to me in this hour is that we've quoted it several times here. I believe it's Psalm 34, but it says that I inquired of the Lord. I prayed to the Lord and he heard me and he answered me. If we'll just ask God, he will answer. He's a God that answers. And we walk around saying we're Christians, we're called by his name, and yet we refuse to inquire and then listen to what he says. Young people, I'm telling you, you'd save yourself a world of trouble if you just ask God what you should do. Like, what do I do, God? He'll answer you. He won't be mute to you. He will talk to you. He will give you the signs that you need. Even to Gideon, Gideon had to have 35 different confirmations. Gideon said, I know, God, that you spoke to me through an angel. Like, I can't even imagine an angel coming to see me. But an angel comes to see him, and then he's like, prepare a meal, and they prepared a meal, and then like fire consumed the meal. As if an angel wasn't enough, let me do this miraculous thing in front of you and tell you what God's got for your life. And then Gideon goes a couple days, and then he's like, you know, Lord, I know you sent me an angel. I know he did that miracle of like fire consuming everything out of nothing. But I'm still just not quite sure. I mean, it was good stuff and all, but I'm, you know, woohoo, God, magic tricks. But I'm gonna need another magic trick, God. I'm gonna need another supernatural sign. So tonight I'm gonna put out a fleece. And it's basically a rug. I'm going to put a rug out, God, and this is what I want you to do. I want you to make dew. And you talk about being specific. He said, I want dew on everything, but no dew on the rug. You know, he was like, it was like we training our dogs. No dew on the rug. You know what I mean? And, sorry, the dad jokes just flow out of me. And so then he says, no dew on the rug. And so God's like, okay, you know, I can see God up there like shaking his head, like I'm going to do it, but you're aggravating me, boy. And so then he's like, he gets it. So now we've got an angel. We've got like disappearing food with fire. Now we've got like no dew on the rug, but dew everywhere, you know? And he's like, you know, God, I'm still just not convinced. I just need to hear from you a little bit more. So I'm going to need you to make dew on the rug today and no dew anywhere else. And like, I can't even imagine how frustrated God is in this moment. You know, he's just like, are you serious? Are you serious? You want me to just come down and do it for you? Like, how many times, has any parents ever said, how many times do I got to tell you? You know, God, I guarantee you that is, somebody heard that prophetically one day from heaven. And then we just recited it to our children, and it has stood the test of time, because God is up there in heaven going, how many times do I got to tell you? How many times do I got to tell you? If you inquire of the Lord, he will speak to you. And then if you're just not sure you heard from him, he'll confirm it. And then if you're just not sure that the confirmation was deep enough and just solid enough, he'll reconfirm it again. And then if you're just not sure that that the two confirmations were enough, he'll reconfirm it again. He's just good like that. So David inquired of the Lord. I haven't even started the message yet. You're getting all kinds of sermons today. And he said, shall I go up against the Philistines? Should I fight this battle? Will you? And then I love this. He didn't just say, should I fight them? He said, will you give me the victory? Like sometimes we ask the wrong questions to the right person, you know? Like he didn't just say, hey, should I go fight? Is it good that I go fight? But he said, am I going to win? Will you give me the victory? I wonder if there's anybody out here today in this audience that would say, not only can I fight, but I know that God makes me win. Not only am I a fighter, but I'm a winner because I've got him inside of me. I just wonder if there's some, I heard a prophetess one day, she said, anybody can fight, but I wonder if there's anybody that says, I know I can win. I know that the God that's on my side is a winner, and so I'm a winner. And David said, will you deliver them into my hands? And the Lord said, go on, go up, for I will doubtless deliver them into your hands. Listen, I like the wording of the Lord, even though it's not modern English. He said, listen, doubtlessly, without a doubt, you are going to win. I love that he put that little nugget in there for David. He said, there's not a chance that you're going to lose. David, I need you to remember, David was the one who went over and gathered some smooth stones because there was a Philistine standing in his way. And he said, even if God doesn't deliver me, I'm going to tell you that uncircumcised Philistine's not going to defy the armies of the living God. He went out without the knowing if he was going to win, but he just trusted the Lord, and he took one stone, smoked that devil right in his head, and took off his chopped his head off with his own sword. Y'all know the story. But this time David said, listen, I don't want to go out to fight a Goliath. This same Philistines, by the way. He said, I don't want to go out to fight a Goliath and not know if I'm going to win this time. You know, God, you put me in king position. I'm getting ahead of myself. But he's just now become king. He's like, you know, I'm a somebody, God. Back then I was just a shepherd boy. Now I got a whole people, a whole responsibility. Am I going to win this thing? And God says, I will doubtlessly. I want you to hear this today. God is saying it to you too. If you'll let him fight your battles, if you say, this is how I fight my battles with my hand, all I did was praise, all I did was worship. If you just let God fight your battles for you, he said, I will doubtless deliver you from all evil. No sickness shall come nigh under your dwelling place. There's so many promises in the word of God. If you'll just let God fight your battles for you, he's undefeated, undisputed, reigning champion of the world. I'm telling you, God's never lost a battle. And if you'll let him fight, he won't start now. Amen. So he says, I'll deliver the Philistines into your hands. So David, here's where it is. I'm going to mess you up. You ready? So David went to Baal. Actually, the correct pronunciation of that word is Baal. But it sounds like you're stuttering when you say it. Baal. He went to Baal. We're going to say it like we're from southern Missouri today. He went to Baal Perazim. Okay? Everybody say Baal Perazim. How many of y'all understand that the name Baal is not usually a good name in the scripture? Remember them prophets that Elijah killed, the prophets of Baal? False god, pagan god. But it says that David went to Baal Perazim. I'm going to mess y'all up today. And David defeated them there. And he said, the Lord, look at this, the Lord has broken through my enemies before me. Like the breakthrough of waters, therefore he, who? David. Therefore he called the name of that place Baal Perazim. Now, I don't know why that David chose to use the name Baal. I really don't know why he chose to use the name Baal. But the word Baal simply means the Lord. But it's like I want you to understand this. It's like us using the word God. God can mean Jehovah God when we want it to, but we can also say God and mean little g gods, false gods. Does that make sense? So this word Baal simply means God. It means the Lord. And this is the only place that I know of in the scripture that actually refers to Jehovah God. And I don't know why David didn't call it El, because normally El is the prefix for when you're going to say the Lord and talk about Jehovah. But David didn't call the name of the place El. He called the name of the place Baal. I was going to just tell you he called it El and just make the sermon a little easier today, but that's not what he did, and the Holy Ghost wouldn't let me do that. So go home and figure it out why he did this, but I want you to understand, David named this place Baal Perazim. And the reason he named this place Baal Perazim is because that meaning is the Lord of the breakthrough. The Lord of the breakthrough, because my God broke through my enemies like waters break through, is what he said. And he called the name of that place the Lord of the breakthrough. And they left their images there, and David and his men carried them away. Who left their images there? The Philistines left their images there, left their false gods, left their Baals there, and he carried them away. I want to tell you today that God is a God of breakthrough. Everybody say breakthrough. Come on, say it again. Say breakthrough. Oh, I like it. And you're almost there, but I want you to shout it like you mean it today. Say breakthrough. Amen. Amen. Father, I pray that you bless this word today, that you let us hear it. Let us be doers of your word. God, anoint me to preach your gospel today, God. Help me to help people, God. Leave this place with the power and unction of the Holy Spirit, with breakthrough in their life, in the strong and powerful name we've been quoting all morning. In Jesus' name, we pray. Everybody say amen. Amen. And amen. Let's look at verse number 21. That last verse, let's look at it one more time. It says, and they left their images there, and David and his men carried them away. Why did I could have stopped at Baal Perazim, the Lord of the breakthrough. I wanted to put that last verse in there to give us some context, to let us understand something, that there was something powerful that was happening in this battle. And it wasn't just a battle that David, because some people came up against David. It wasn't just a battle where like somebody picked a fight with David and he had to defend himself, okay? I want you to understand this. I want you to see it. There was a result of this battle. The result of the battle was that they left their idols. They left their images. They left their pagan gods. They left the things. Let me tell you what this verse equates to, what it really is saying. It's saying that false gods died and revival happened. That's what that scripture says. They left their images there, and David and his men carried them away. What is revival exactly? Revival is when God arises and his enemies scatter. I'm going to say that again. What is revival? Revival is when God arises and his enemies scatter. When God's name is the loudest name in a region, that's when you've got revival. When God's name begins to break through the spiritual darkness in a place, that's when you have revival. When bars begin to close down, that's when you have revival. When strip joints begin to close down, that's when you know you have revival. I'm on metal a little bit today. When the casinos close down, that's when you know that you've got revival. Revival. Listen, when all the pot shops begin to close down, that's when you know you have revival. I know some of y'all, I'm messing with you right now. I don't mind meddling for a minute, but I desire revival to hit Battle Creek. I desire revival to hit Calhoun County. One thing I came back from a conference this weekend with is a desire for this city. I heard somebody say, don't be a pastor to your church. Be a pastor to your city. You've got to shepherd your city. You've got to fight for your city. And I came today to fight for Battle Creek. So even if you won't fight, I got it inside of me. I'm fighting for this city. I'm believing God's going to bring revival. I'm believing they're going to lay down their images, and we are going to carry them off in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I got some fighters in the house today. Make no mistake, this was a battle of gods. I need you to see that. This was not the Philistines and David. This was not David and Goliath. This wasn't, why is this so important? Because you need to understand that that person attacking you It's not you and them. You need to get it. You need to understand that person that stands opposed to you, it's not Susie versus Sally. It's not Bob versus Jim. It's little G gods versus the God. Listen, you need to see this today. This was a battle of the gods. The Philistines heard that David was king. Oh my God. They heard that David was king, and they took it personal. This Goliath beater, they were mad at David. They were mad that David had the audacity to kill their giant, this little puny boy. And they hated David ever since. And so they got wind that David had been lifted up. I got to stop right there and tell you, when the enemy hears that you've been lifted up, when the enemy hears that God's got good things in your future, listen, you think that you think you're being battled because you don't even know why. You're like, I don't know why the devil won't leave me alone. I'm just little old me. But you don't understand that the devil knows there's greatness on the inside of you. The devil knows that if he can thwart the before you ever get started, he's going to get you. That's why there's a spirit of abortion in this world today. I know I'm going to go ahead and meddle in everything today. That's why there's a spirit of abortion in this world today, because the devil wants to stop things before they ever get started. He knows that there's somebody in a womb somewhere who's going to be a leader to a generation. He knows that there's somebody somewhere who's going to be a voice that's going to shatter darkness. And he said, if I can abort it before it ever gets a chance to live, then I've done my job. And the same thing, that spirit of abortion is not just killing babies today. It's killing your destiny, because it's trying to abort what God has placed on the inside of you. There's a spirit of abortion. And every day you wake up and you sit there and battle with hitting the abort button on your life and saying, I wonder if I should abort. I wonder if I should abort the mission. I wonder if I should abort life. I wonder if I should abort my marriage. I wonder if I should abort my friendships. I wonder if I should abort this. I wonder if I should abort that. And God is saying, don't abort it. I've got a destiny for you. I've got something big on the inside of you. Don't stop fighting for what God has for you.
I feel this thing today. I feel like meddling. The battle of the gods. There's a battle of the gods happening right now. It's happening in a global sense. It's happening in this United States. It's funny that we're called the United States. We might as well be called the Divided States. Let me tell you something. This is not political. I promise you, I will not be political today in this pulpit. If you think I'm political, it's because you don't know God. Because I'm only saying gospel truth to you today. I just messed up, didn't I? I told somebody they don't know God. I'm not being political. These are not political issues. God is the giver of life. You think abortion's a political issue? My God, man, you've missed the whole thing. It's not a political issue. Just because there's a divide between political parties, that has nothing to do. I don't care whether you're red, blue, green, yellow, black, or white. I don't care what your affiliation is. God's a God of life. And if he gives life, who are we to take it away? It's a battle of the gods. It's a battle of the gods. I'm going to just go ahead and meddle and mess. I'm probably going to lose somebody over this. But if you're motivated to abort anything, a child, your life, your destiny, and if you're motivated to just hit the abort button at all, I'm telling you, you are being guided and tormented and spoken to by an evil spirit. And you need to tell the thing to shut up, get behind you, get under your feet. I know you don't want to hear it today. You may think this is your mindset. This is how I believe. Well, listen, change your belief. Repent. That's what repentance actually means. Change your beliefs. Change the way you think. Because God does not believe that way. That's not God. Change your beliefs. I think I'm going to stop. I don't know if I'm going to stop. This is a battle of the gods. David was fighting a battle of the gods. See, the Philistines, it was personal to them. It was personal to them. I love this. I love this. They were like, we're going to get David back. Goliath couldn't get him, but we got a lot of men that will fight him. We will kill him. Like, we'll get the power in numbers. It was personal. I make no mistake,
The battle against David was personal. The battle, see this thing, your battle that's against you, it's personal. That's why it affects you so much. It's personal. You know, we get hurt the most by the people that are closest to us because it's personal. I asked a leader, or the question was asked, what's your biggest mistake? What would you have told yourself if you could start all over being the leader that you are today? He said, don't give people too much too fast. He said, trust people and work people. Don't give people too much too fast, because every time I've been hurt, it's because I've given people too much too fast. Good piece of advice for you. But it gets personal. What you're going through in your life, I'm not minimizing it today. Some of you are dealing with sons and daughters situations. Some of you are dealing with health situations. Some of you are dealing with friendships. Some of you are dealing with broken marriages. Some of you, I mean, the list goes on, and I understand. And I'm not making light of that. It's very personal. Because the enemy wants to make it personal. He sees you and he hates you. The enemy of your soul hates you. He wants to steal from you. He wants to kill you. And he wants to destroy your heritage, your legacy, your lineage. He wants to destroy you. But God, everybody say, but God, came to give you life. And not just life, life more abundantly. Abundant life, but it's a battle of the gods. And so these Philistines, I got to get to this. I'm just on point one. I do this every week. Jesus help me. It's a battle of the gods, and you keep looking at your situation and you think that it only affects you and your family. You keep looking at your situation and you're like, you know, this is a battle that I'm struggling with, and it's personal. It's personal, and I just need to keep it personal. I'm just going to share it, maybe with a couple of interceding friends that I have, but it's a very personal issue that I have, and the devil's fighting, you know. Has anybody ever just felt like that? The devil's fighting me. The devil's fighting me. The devil's fighting me and my wife. The devil's fighting my children. You know what I'm saying? Because it's personal. Let me tell you something. It's personal, and this was personal to the Philistines, to David. But they got it all messed up. The perspective was all wrong. Because while it's personal for the devil to you, it's not personal to you. Let me tell you why. Listen, you're going to love this. I love this. I feel it in my heart. Because they're not battling you. They're battling the God on the inside of you. Well, wait a minute. You don't even have it processed just yet. They're not battling you, Mike. The Philistines didn't hate David. They thought they hated David. What they hated was that on the inside of David was a heart that was after God. They didn't hate David. They thought they hated David personally. You know, there's probably some people who hate me. Just keep to yourself if you do. There's people that hate me. And you know what? I know devils hate me. And I'm ecstatic about devils hating me. I'm excited about devils hating me. But they don't hate me. They think they hate me. They hate Paul. I imagine they thought they hated the Apostle Paul too. And I'm not even close. Okay? I'm not trying to compare. But they don't hate you. They hate the God that's on the inside of you. Let me tell you something. Now let's flip that. Let's flip that paradigm right now. You need to understand this. It's not personal to you because it's God. But God told me to tell you today, he takes it personal. The attack that's on you is the attack on him. And he is taking it personally. And so the devil thinks that he's fighting you directly when really he's fighting God. And it's a battle of the gods. But the little g god devil is trying to fight you, but God's saying you don't even need to fight this because I'm taking it personal what's happening to you. I need you to understand God is taking it personal the attack that's happening in your life. God is taking it personal and he wants to fight that battle for you. He's saying, listen, I am taking it personally. I am personally offended. The devil thinks he's fighting you, but he's really fighting me. I wish somebody get a hold of that thing today. That makes me want to run the aisles of this place because I start to understand that I don't even have to fight this thing because they done made my daddy mad. And when you make my daddy mad, he ain't never been defeated. When you make my daddy mad, he calls up my co-heir, my brother Jesus, and he says, listen, devil, I already put you under my feet one time before, and I'm telling you, he's coming to fight on your behalf. He's coming to fight on your behalf. It's personal. Look at your neighbor, say, it's personal. But not the way you think. Not the way you think. It's personal to God. Oh, that we would get perspective. If you could leave with one thing today, this is what I want you to leave with. That God cares about you so much that he doesn't want you to handle anything on your own. Listen, I know that sounds super basic. You don't get it though, because you still try and fight battles alone all the time. You still just try, you just try and do this thing on your own. When all you have to do, listen, the most beautiful picture to me is the picture of John, of all the disciples, that John got in and he got in close to Jesus. And he snuggled up to Jesus. I know you don't want to hear that verbiage, but he laid into Jesus and he laid his head on the bosom of Jesus, close enough to hear the heartbeat of God. And let me tell you something, it was a powerful moment where he was close to God. But in that moment, I don't know if anybody can get this in your spirit, but when you get close enough to God, you understand that you are under his protection. And you get close enough to God and you start to live out that scripture where Jesus said, Father, I would that they would be one as we are one, and you become one with God, and you understand that the attack on you is an attack on him. And let me show it to you in a very practical sense, worldly sense right now. We used to be at least a nation that would say that if you attacked one American, whether on land or abroad, if you attacked one of us, you were attacking us. You're attacking the sovereignty of America. There was a time when we used to say, if you kill one of ours, what, no matter what land you're on, that's an act of war. And now, listen, we may not be that way right now. We've lost a little backbone. I'm not political right now. I'm just telling you where we are. I'm just telling you. But God is still like that. He says, if you attack one of mine, devil, I'm taking it personally. And you're not going to attack one of mine because it's an attack on my sovereignty. And I will beat you. God said, I'm taking it personal. And we know that because in verse 21, he says, when the battle was over, they left all the false images behind. Revival. It's a battle of the gods. This is what you need to understand. What you're facing, two things you need to understand. What you're facing is a battle of the gods, not a battle of you and whoever you're battling. I could put names on it in my own life. I'm going to not meddle like that today. I do that too often. But what you're fighting, you need to know two things about it. One, it's not personal to you. It's personal to God. And number two, it's way bigger than you. It's way bigger than your personal situation. David thought he was fighting a personal battle, only to understand that when God gave him the victory over an army, he was going to carry away all the idols, that he was going to bring a revolution, a spiritual revolution. You're probably like Gideon today, you know, back to Gideon. You're probably like Gideon where you're like, it's just me. I'm the least in my house, you know, just little old me. And I just got me and my three and, you know, whatever it is. And you're just saying, you know, it can't be that big. Let me tell you, it is that big. Your victory could be the thing that ignites revival in Battle Creek. I don't want to put something on you to make it weighty, because it's not yours anyway, it's God's. But I need you to understand that personal battle you're going through could very well be the thing that brings, when you get victory, when you allow God to give you victory, could be the very thing that brings revival to, not just to your house, not just to you, to a region. It can bring revival to a region, because there's power in somebody who gets a testimony. There's power in somebody who God works a miracle in them and they begin to testify about it. There's power. You want to know how to grow a church? Let God begin to do some miraculous things in the lives of people in the church. They will noise it abroad that God's in the house. And other people will say, you know what? If God's doing that for them, I think he might be able to do it for me. And I'm going to come and check out what God is doing and see if I can become a recipient of what God is doing. That's how you grow a church. That's how you grow the ecclesia of God. That's how you grow the kingdom of God. You get people excited about what God's done in you. We've lost our testimony because we quit trusting God and letting him make it personal. I'm gonna move on. How does God do it when it's personal? How does God do it? He does it through breakthrough. You need to see this, and I'm going to hit and run on this. We're going to close pretty soon. But when God, don't laugh, Brother Rick. I'm being somewhat serious. He chuckled when I said I was going to close pretty soon. I love you, brother. Keeping me honest. So the way God does it when it's personal is he does it through breakthrough. There's a powerful picture of what breakthrough is. And anybody who's ever done any martial arts or anything like that, you know, you go through the testing and the forms and stuff, and you usually have to break, you know, blocks and different numbers of blocks. You all seen that, you know, in karate, they break the numbers of blocks and stuff like that. And anybody ever see somebody like try to break a block, but it doesn't break? It's just like, you know, like, I know that had to hurt. You know what I mean? But there's something, if you could slow motion, if you could slow down the picture of what happens when things break through, if you could slow that down, you would see that the force of the breakthrough was so powerful that the object that was in its way had no chance. And I have done this before. There's things, like I'm not even proud about this. It's just an experience, okay? There's things I've punched and they didn't move and my hand hurt, okay? And then there's things I've punched and they did move and my hand didn't hurt, okay? There's something about having the power to break through. And let me tell you, God's got all the power. So you need to understand that when God does it and it's personal, he does it in breakthrough. There's a reason that David called the place the Lord of the Breakthrough. It's because he watched as God took it personal, the attack that was on him. And he said, when I came up, he said, I set myself in array and I watched what God did. And he said, the Lord has broken through my enemies like floodwaters break through a levee, like floodwaters break a dam. Like when floodwaters, has anybody ever seen, do you got a picture in your mind of what it looks like when a dam breaks? And it might start with a little pew of water, but the next thing you know, I mean, it is just massive in the foot pounds of energy that's coming out of that dam or out of that breach is just incredible. Nothing can hold it back. Before you know it, one little crack in the dam just blows open and you've got these waters because there's this incredible pressure, this incredible power that's behind the breakthrough. And God told me to tell you today, when I fix your situation, I'm not going to do it with a little band-aid kind of fix. I'm not going to do it with just a little, like, let me fix it gradually a little bit at a time. God said, no, this is personal. And so that's why I'm going to bring breakthrough into your life. I'm going to cause you to have breakthrough because I take it personal. The only reason we can have breakthrough in our lives is because we have a God who takes our problems personally. And so he wants to break through, and he wants to break through with all the power of floodwaters. That's the first thing you need to understand about breakthrough. This is powerful. The second thing you need to understand about breakthrough is it's invasive. Breakthrough is invasive. Anybody ever dealt with a flood? I remember, so it's not as big a deal up here, but in Missouri, I lived in the St. Louis area during the flood of 1993. Yes, I'm that old. I was like one. No, I remember like, I actually remember this. I'm going to tell on myself, I think, maybe for the first time, and it's going to be captured on video, so somebody's going to be mad at me. But it was flooding at our house during the floods of 93. I lived in the St. Louis area, and we came home, and we brought my sister Morgan home from the hospital during the floods. And she was just a couple days old, and I remember coming home from the hospital, and we drove a Ford Tempo at that time. And we were driving up our drive, and I mean, you couldn't tell where the road was. There is flood. It's 8-10 inches of flood water. We're just driving through water on all the roads everywhere. We lived in a low-lying river area. Pulled into the driveway, and there were waters coming up to the bottom of the vehicle, you know, just right at the door. just waters. And I remember being about 12 years old and like stepping out into that water. And there was like, everybody's getting their feet wet tonight before we get inside the house. And we stepped out. And I remember traversing the floodwaters, my dad carrying Morgan in, she's a newborn infant. And they go inside and I'm just mesmerized by this flood that's happening. I mean, it was like, there's water everywhere all around our house. We didn't have sandbags up or anything. And I was just so, you know, enamored with this flood that I had to see it again. So everybody was in one room of the house because the floodwaters were kind of coming against one side of the house down the valley. And waters were coming in kind of through the bottom of the walls and in the door. And it had come in about halfway through like our family room area and stuff. Well, while they were all there, I went around to the front porch, to front door. And I said, I want to see the floodwaters. And I opened the door and flooded the whole living room and the whole kitchen and everything. Nobody knows that until today. So sorry, Dad. Sorry, Grandma Judy. But I had to see it. So if you've ever been, so I remember after that flood, I mean, at that point we had knee deep water in the whole house, you know, all the way through, just water. I mean, the house was flooded. And if you've ever experienced a flood, one thing that you learn is that water gets everywhere. Water will find its way into everything. Most time, whether you have a vehicle or a house or whatever, if it gets flooded, it's a total loss. I did some work after Hurricane Katrina, and one of the main issues in New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina was not the wind that came from the hurricane. It was the breach of the waters when levees would break, and there was a storm surge, a storm swell, and it would come in, and most of the areas that I was working in had 4 or 5 feet of water. People had to hide in their attics and get, you know, bust through their roof to be able to get rescued. But what you learn about floodwaters is that they are invasive. What you need to understand about breakthrough, if God breaks through and it's like waters break through, is that when God causes breakthrough to happen in your life, it's going to be invasive into your life. This is why sometimes we don't want breakthrough in our lives. Because we don't want God looking at every nook and cranny of our lives. We don't want the power of the Holy Spirit to come and check what we're doing at night. We don't want the Holy Spirit to know what movies are in our collection. We don't want the Holy Spirit to know, you know, what our favorites list is for our TV shows. We don't want the Holy, I know I'm meddling again. We don't want the Holy Spirit to know what we're doing, you know, in our private conversations with our work buddies. We don't want the Holy Spirit to know that I'm doing a little bit of flirting right now, but it's all innocent and, you know, but you're wondering if it's going to lead to something else. I know I'm meddling right now, but I want you to understand, when God breaks through for you, it's going to be invasive, and you have to decide in your heart that if he's going to take it personal what the enemy's doing and he's going to bring breakthrough, that you're going to allow the invasion of the Holy Spirit into your life, that you're going to say, God, whatever it takes for me to get breakthrough in my life, I will take it, even if it means invading every area of my life. I'll just go ahead and receive what you're doing. Go ahead and let the waters of the flood just overtake me, God, like rivers of living water. Let it just overtake every aspect of my life. Anything that's not washed away in a flood will be saturated. That's good. Anything that's not washed away in a flood, that's what God's going to do when he breaks through in your life. I'm just teaching for a moment. When God breaks through in your life, he's going to wash away all the things that need wash away, and he's going to saturate the things that stay. I want you to think about that. God, I want you to just close your eyes and lift your hands right now. Father, in Jesus' name, I want you to wash away everything that's not you. And I want you to saturate everything that can be saturated by you. Breakthrough. Breakthrough, God. Breakthrough. And the third thing you need to understand is this. Often in the aftermath of a flood, there's a devastation. I know that's not a